Hi, how are you? Let's study the Bible together again. Today we like to study from Book of Romans, and we're going to take a look at it from the Romans chapter 1, verse 15. Now, this is Book of Romans written by Paul, and the reason he wrote this book was that as Paul was traveling around in Asia Minor, the current Turkey area, that he heard the rumor that there is a new church is formed in Rome, and it's mostly it's a new convert from the it encompasses of the Roman citizens and also Jewish people. They get together and just started a new church in the Rome. So he decided to write this book to make sure that their theology, particularly salvation, is correct. So he decided to write it to tell them about what is a correct gospel, what is a right gospel or salvation. And let's read from the Romans chapter 1, verse 15. That is why I am so eager to preach the gospel also to you who are in Rome. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes. First to Jew, then to the Gentile. For in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith. The wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of people who suppress the truth by their wickedness. Well, here, clearly the Paul indicating he would like to tell them about the gospel and about the salvation. Now, the questions are, when you talk about gospel, the questions are that what will be saved from? I mean, why we have to believe in gospel? And but let me ask you some questions. Have you ever concerned or worried about about death? Have you ever worried that you might die someday? And the fact is, we all will die. But you know, have you ever thought about what happens after you die? And this is not other people's matter, but this is a matter of everyone's, and everyone will eventually going to face it. But what will happen after we die? At the same time, you probably wonder, is there a God? If there is God, we should ask Him to save us, or, you know, to make sure that we don't die. But if there is no God, there's no hope. But the questions are, is there God? Let me read, let me continue to read from verse 19. Since what may be known about God is plain to them, because God has made it plain to them. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible quality, His eternal power and divine nature have been seen, have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse. Here, the Paul clearly indicate that it is clearly we can see that God's existence from the things are made by Him. All the creation that we see, the surrounding, our surrounding, the universe, that itself will really proclaiming the glory of God. So it is very clear that there is God. Now, let me give you some example on this. Do you know how vast, how big the universe is? Let's assume that the diameter of the Earth to be like 0.1 millimeter. Do you know 0.1 millimeter is very, very small. It's like maybe most of you probably familiar with like a mechanical pencil with a 0.5 millimeter, or point, maybe some narrow, small as a 0.3 millimeter. But 0.1 millimeter is like even 1/5 or 1/3 of that mechanical pencil, the tip of the mechanical pencil. And so 0.1 millimeter, let's assume if it's the diameter of the Earth to be a 0.1 millimeter, then the diameter of the sun will be about 1 centimeter. The diameter of our solar, the sun, is about 1 centimeter. That's about this size. See that? You see that the little ball here? This is about 1 centimeter diameter ball. This is exactly about 1 centimeter diameter ball. And then this is the sun. But do you know how far from this sun to the next sun in the our universe? Do you know how far it is? If I have, I live in Osaka, Japan right now, so if I have this sun right here, if it is, the next sun is somewhere around like Shizuoka or Hiroshima. That's pretty far. If in the United States, since I used to live in Chicago, if this sun located in Chicago, the next sun will be somewhere like Detroit. And that's far, and between is nothing there. And that's a distance of two stars. And so if you just imagine, even within just a Milky Galaxy, there's billions of stars up there in heaven. And you see the Milky Way is just one of a galaxy. There's a thousand of countless the galaxy in within our universe. And that's a very vast universe, something we cannot, it's beyond our comprehension, actually. But then the whole universe, even though it's humongous and gigantic, but the whole universe still made very ordinary and very followed some rule. And all that, you know, rule of discovered by Newton or Kepler and all that great scientists have discovered, all the rule on the universe is already there. And this entire universe follows the rule, which is amazing. And that is something how ordinary, how wonderful the universe is. And that is the reason the scientists can tell about 100 years from now where each star will be, or maybe 100 years ago where the star was. And so that is how ordinary the entire star system in our galaxy, our universe. And for us to understand, the other example I can give you is, if you have a computer right in front of you, and probably nobody will think that computer itself was created by itself or accidentally all the dust on the air kind of start to accumulate it and become a computer. And no one will believe. If I say that, you think I'm crazy. But nevertheless, if you look at the computer, you can tell that whoever made that computer, it must be extremely intelligent person. Otherwise, how they can make computer, you can see that maybe first you can start notice like a logo of the manufacturer of the computer, and then you notice that the computer is made very delicate but yet beautiful, and it is so wonderful the way the computer was made. And but unless you realize that was made by an intelligent person, it's hard for people to imagine the computer was made by accident, which is impossible. But when you look at our surrounding, all the like natures and even one small life, even the one cell, if we look at it, it is very, very detailed and intricate and then very perfect. We see that even the computers may be not perfect, but what we see in the nature is really a perfect, beautiful too. And that's how we can tell there's God, some intelligent beings actually created all this. See, the scientists, we think the scientists is great. They are, but all they did was they discovered. They didn't make those life or butterflies or bug, or they didn't make those things. They didn't make dog or cat. They discover the things in nature, and then more they discover, they are amazed. All the scientists, like Newton's and all that, they found the mystery of the universe maybe, but those are what's already existed. And before the scientists found, all they did was just found something new, and something they didn't know. Even that the smallest things in our life, such as the two cells separate each other, and even that, the scientists can explain the mechanism of the how the cell separate in two, but why that happened, that we cannot explain. I mean, without knowing there is God, it's very difficult for us to understand. Without the without God's presence, it's very difficult for us to understand the what's happening in our surroundings. So the Bible revealed to us there's no excuse. Just think about it. I mean, some people said that universe started from nothing. But if there's a nothing, absolutely, absolutely nothing, no matter how long you wait, the result is nothing, because it's nothing. So if we are here, and if there's a universe here, which means when in the beginning, there was something. It's not a nothing, but there was something, and the Bible revealed to us that in the beginning, there was a word, and the word, which is God himself he proclaimed and made this entire universe. So there was a word according to Bible, but you know, sometimes we try not to believe that, and there's evidence of God exists, and there is God so obvious in our surrounding nature, but mostly we try not to listen to. And which is sad, but that's what exactly Paul explained here in the Bible. It is so clear that God does exist in our surroundings. But let me read from verse 21. For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God, nor gave thanks to him. But their thinking became futile, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like mortal human beings and birds and animals and reptiles. Therefore, God gave them over in the sinful desire of their hearts to sexual impurity for the degrading of their bodies with one another. They exchanged their truth about God for a lie and worshipped and served created things rather than the Creator, who is forever praised. Amen. Well, here, the people in Rome, they are very smart people, by the way. The Roman people are very smart. And if you went to Rome right now, you can see the humongous building such as Colosseum. And, you know, the building was made during the Roman time, Roman Empire. They're very clever people. They can build humongous monument. Yet the Roman people worship idols, and it's amazing at how smart they are. But yet they worship idol. This kind of remind me about Japanese. I think it's a smart people, but yet many Japanese does worship idol, and those idol. They're nothing but made of rock and wood and the metal, and it's made by men. Now, concerning about the Americans, most of Americans probably does not worship idol, and some does, by the way, but then most of Americans doesn't do that, but then still, if trusting, I would say Americans, they trust money more than God. And whoever you worship or whatever you trust in, and that's actually same as worshiping idol. And I think American people, many Americans worship money and the fame, or be success is the most important thing. And I think that's just equally stupid, and just like those idol worshipper. But either way, so here the Bible revealed to us that they are very smart people. The Roman people are very smart, but yet the Paul indicate they worship idol God, which is very unwise. And but let me explain what happened was God is God of Creator. He created everything with His word, and whatever He does, whatever He decide, that is something we call righteous or good. See, that how you can tell what is right and wrong? Sometimes we humans had a hard time deciding what is right and wrong, but even though somewhere in deep our heart, we know something wrong or something right. For example, if it's wrong to kill people, or rape a person, and those things we know it is wrong. The reason we know is because it is God is one righteous. It is a God's. God made the rule what is righteous in the universe. So there is something we call absolute righteous, which is God's righteousness. And there's something right and something wrong. And we human kind of knew it too. And this absolute righteousness that who God is. Now God made man, human, and the angel is very close to him, looks like him that we are. The reason for that being that we both have the angels and the human, we both have a word or language, and we can talk to God, we can communicate with God, we can have a fellowship with God. God decided to create us like that. The same time as we obtain the God likeness, the word. We also have, because we have word, we have a free will. And with our own word, we could deny God's righteousness. We could say something absolutely beautifully right. We kind of knew it that is right because God is right. Everything he does in this entire universe, actually he's the only one exists in this universe in a way that everything he does is right. So to fit with his own righteousness, is right, but we could deny that. We could say something right, but we could say that's not right. And something to against God's righteousness, something off from the his righteousness, that's a sin. See, the word sin means out of focus or it's not on a target. And that is a word for Hebrew or Greek both, means what the sin means. And sin, we are not righteous. We don't conform with God's righteousness. We're kind of against God's righteousness, and the result of that is a pain and death. I can give you some example for us to understand this. Like if you jump off from the tall building, and there is a God's rule called gravity, but if you try to against that, eventually you fall from the building. And then you will be landed in the ground and extremely pain, and then many cases you will die. So the against God's rule, eventually we have to we will die and cease to exist otherwise with the pain and suffering, and that is a result of being unrighteous. But that's how who we are, and If we look at it like this way too, if you have some murderer, so somebody killed someone and that person escaped, and if we watch that TV show and we watch a news, vicious murderer running around in the street right now, and we kind of wanted this person to be captured and arrested and put into the jail. And have a right judgment upon that person. And just like that, if we don't judge, if God doesn't judge the unrighteous act of somebody, unrighteous act, the God himself won't be righteous. Because he had to be, for him to be righteous, he cannot let those criminal things or bad things or unrighteous things to stay exist. And if he let those unrighteous things, unrighteous beings such as human to be exist where it is, then he's not righteous, he's not right. So eventually the result of that being unrighteous is a death. And that is exactly the reason for us dying, and we end up in the unrighteous place. Okay, let's read here and remaining the verse 26, verse 26. Because of this, God gave them over to shameful lust. Even their women exchanged natural sexual relation for unnatural ones. In the same way, the men also abandon natural relationship with women and are inflamed with lust for one another. Men committed shameful act with other men and received in themselves the due penalty for their error. Here is the very sexual immorality indicated. As you know, the place like even Japan or US, it's a nice country, but just behind there, those, you know, big city, there's some sexual immorality business going on. This is not only Japan, the US, everywhere in the world. Or maybe even there's some kind of victim of the rape and all that. It's actually happening. That is a fact. That is our society. Unfortunately, there's a lots sexual immorality going everywhere. And verse 28, furthermore, just as they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, so God gave them over to depraved mind, so that they do what ought not to do, not to be done. Verse 29, they have become filled with every kind of wickedness, evil greed, that depravity. So greed and depravity. They are full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, and malice. They are gossips, slanders, God-haters, insolent, arrogant, and boastful. They invent way of doing evil. They disobey their parents. They have no understanding, no fidelity, no love, no mercy. Do you know, if we are really love each other, I don't think we will have a war. But unfortunately, the reason every nation have a military, I think each country, you know, think about themselves. They have no mercy, no love. They're just only thinking about, you know, inventing way of doing evil to others. And unfortunately, each country wanted to do something bad to others, so they don't, you know, that's kind of sad. That is a fact. It's not, maybe not between the countries, but maybe between neighbors, or even we are not so good. And verse 32, although they know God's righteous decree that those who do such things deserve death, they not only continue to do these very things, but also approve of those who practice them. Now, we see here that God is righteous and God is totally holy, and He's only one right. Then we kind of understand that the sin, in a way that if you kill people or if you rape person and stuff, that's a very big crime and that's a sin. But that's not enough for us to be holy, for us to have a fellowship with God, that we should be totally holy. But we really can't. See, the Bible reveal, even you lie even once in your life, that's not good enough to be holy. Even you say something bad about your brothers and sisters or your people around you, and you say stupid even once in your life, that's not good enough. Even once you look at that you look at the woman and with the lustful eyes, even you didn't do anything, but even you thought about something dirty in your mind, even once in your life, that's good. That is sin. And far as we have a sin, and we can escape from it, we are not good enough to associate with God. God eventually have to punish us. And that's the only way we can be. God don't have to punish us is for Him to make somebody sacrifice themselves, substitutions death. What I mean is, like, we will be punished, but God, He became Himself man, and He decided to punish the God-man, the Jesus, on the cross. And the cross is a substitution death. And this particular substitution death is only way we can be saved. And this actually follows God's rule, because substitution death, you die for somebody. It's actually, it's something called love. It's a rule, God's rule of love. Just like a parents, when the, parents very much sacrificing themselves to raise their child, and this is sacrificing love, is, it is really followed with God's righteousness. Therefore, God, this is the only way He could unpunish us, by punishing somebody else instead of us. And so that somebody else, He decided to become a man Himself. And this is what's so amazing about the whole thing, is that He went up the cross and He punished God's Son Himself on the cross. And if we accept that, we are still sinful, by the way. We are not clean at all. We are not holy. But if we just accept Jesus is our Savior, and this is only way, only right way to be saved, that God will not, don't have to punish us. He already punished somebody else. This is more like if somebody commit a crime, and then that person was arrested, and the person supposed to go to jail, but instead of that person go to jail, somebody else is went to jail for him or for her, and that person don't have to go to jail, so this person is free. You know, can you believe that? And only criteria is that person accept that somebody else is go to jail instead of him. And he said, oh, that's good news. And why he goes and I will be free, even though you yourself is the one commit the sin. But God has decided that God Himself went to jail and instead of us, or get all the punishment of the sin that we're supposed to receive. This particular way is the only way. And this does follow the God's rule, God's righteous rule. So God is amazing and a perfect being. He made this rule that he did not break any of His righteous rule. Everything He does is right and righteous. And He really followed the rule of Himself, yet He made the way that He doesn't have to punish us. That is a good news. That's called gospel. That is the good news. And that is a salvation, which means we are saved from death. We are saved from punishment. We don't have to die. So that is the amazing good news. Let me read from the same Roman. Now I'm going to skip to Roman chapter 3, verse 23. So if you are in the chapter 1 in the Roman, you can flip a few pages and go to the Roman chapter 3, verse 23. Let me read this. Romans 3, verse 23. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and all are justified freely by His grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of His blood to be received by faith. He did this to demonstrate His righteousness, because in His forbearance He had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. He did it to demonstrate His righteousness at the present time, so as to be just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. Here, see that God Himself, if He let unrighteous to stay and not be punished, God cannot be righteous. You know, God is, for God to be righteous, this is the only way He can do is punish, and somebody else is punished, and something called substitution death, substitute, I mean like somebody else to take their place. And that's exactly what God did on the cross. And so all we have to do is accept that and believe that. And whoever accept God and His offering, that person be righteous. Unfortunately, we could deny that too. Since we do have a word ourselves, we do have a free will to choose God or not choose God. So people who decide not to choose God, they'll still being unrighteous and eventually being judged. So they will die and go to the eternal place for death. But people who believe in Jesus, we don't die anymore from that point. We have eternal life. Unfortunately, we have this flesh. This body came from our parents. That came from Adam. So our flesh was still cursed, and our flesh still desires sin. See, even become a Christian, you will commit sin, like a small lie. That's not good enough to be righteous. Some Christian misunderstood about salvation. That is, soon as you become a Christian, you have to be holy. You have to. You cannot do any sin. But the fact is, that's not what the Bible said. We will go to the Christ as we are sinful. God still forgive us, and our current sin, past sin, and the future sin, all that was already forgiven 2,000 years ago. So all we have to do is we go to Jesus as we are. It's not like you have to clean up all your sin, which is impossible because you still have a corrupt body. So once you become Christian, once you accept Christ, even though you are very corrupted, cursed, and unrighteous, wicked, but God look at the Christ's blood, and He will declare you as righteous. So if you Christian to die means we don't die anymore, but we have to let this flesh, this body go. And that looks like a dying, but Christian is not really dying, because after we get rid of this flesh, this corrupted body, our spirit and soul, it's go up to the heaven, and our spirit be alive. Now we can communicate with God. We can pray to God. And as soon as you became a Christian, you can start communicating with God as you are on this earth already. And that's kind of assurance that you have eternal life, that God's Holy Spirit come upon you. And that's assurance that we can go to heaven and we have eternal life. Let me read the verse 8. From one. Now, some Christians think is once you believe, if you commit the sin again, you will lose your salvation. The fact is not. Your sin, your future sin, your past sin, everything is already forgiven. Not because of you, not because of us doing good things. It's because of Jesus went up the cross. He already forgave us all our sins, even our future sins. So we will not lose our salvation at all. Once you accept that Jesus died for you, for our sin, that which is great news actually. This is amazing. Our salvation not going to be ceased to exist. We all continue to be saved. Romans chapter 8, verse 1. Let me read this. You can flip a few pages to go to Romans chapter 8, verse 1. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. See, here, therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Let me read is end of chapter 8 in the Romans, chapter 8, verse 38. Romans chapter 8, verse 38. This is the last part of my message today. Romans chapter 8, verse 8. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither heights nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So the correct gospel is that first of all, Jesus died for us, and that we should believe in. And if we do, we have eternal life. And once you're saved, your salvation is secure. And God give you eternal life, and he does not have to punish us, even though it's not mean we are right or we're good. And then once you become a Christian, however, since that God's Spirit is residing in us, we'll try to be a good person. We try not to commit the sin, even though it is almost impossible, but God does help us by the power of the Holy Spirit. So gradually, the Christian person, as you become a mature, you start to become much better person and as on this earth. And that's basically the sanctification. We will become more closer to God as we live in the Christian life. Okay, well, shall we pray? Lord, thank you for this time that we learn your word. And lots of people seems confused about the gospel. And so the Paul wrote the book of Romans to clarify that what is gospel, what is really salvation. And thank you that you teach us your word today. And we know for sure that if we believe in Jesus, and his substitution death is for ours and to forgive our sin. He did that. He went up on the cross. If we accept that, we have eternal life, because now God don't look at our sin, but God look at the blood of Jesus, and so that he will save us. He already has saved us. Lord, thank you for this wonderful gospel. Then also, once we're saved, our salvation not going to be disappear. We'll always be saved. Thank you for this assurance. Jesus, we pray. Amen. Okay, have a nice day. Bye.